As with all questions, take a look at the number of marks available for each section. Break the questions down into bite-sized chunks and deal with each item bit by bit. So we start off with our convertible bonds. If the examiner tells us what the item is, let's make sure that we make it very clear for the marker exactly what we are dealing with. So I'm going to do part B first, and then perhaps we'll have a go at part A. So Aron issued the bonds in June X5. Let's take a look at the years. Notice we are at X8. So these bonds were issued some time ago. We split the bonds between the debt component and the equity component. The debt is calculated at the issue date of the 1st of June X5 as the cash flows, assuming that repayment is made, discounted by the interest rate, on similar non-convertible bonds. I've seen that there's 6 marks available, so that gives me a rough idea of the amount to write. So yeah, I've tried to come up with a couple of points. I'll probably be thinking 2 marks for the discussion, 4 marks for the calculations. I'm familiar with the calculations. So if we do our bond calculation, what we would say is on the 31st of May, X6, interest is paid annually in arrears at 6%, so it's going to be 6 million discounted at 9%. And the same happens the following year, discount by a further 9%. And then at the issue date, we would assume that all of the debt is repaid. So that's going to be the 100 million plus the 6 million interest, discounted for 3 years. That gives us a figure of 92.4 million. And therefore, equity is the balance of 6 million. So we would have debited cash, 100 million, credited equity with 7.6, and then credit the debt with 92.4. It then says the company incurred issue costs of 1 million. The issue costs should be deducted. From the proceeds of the issue on a pro rata basis. Therefore, what we would do is that we would credit cash. Our issue costs are 1 million. And we would debit the bond. If you take a look here, can you see 92.4% of the issue was allocated to debt? So I'm going to debit the bond 0.924, and I'm going to debit equity 0.076. Interest is charged on the net debt figure of 92.4 less 0.924. So that's 91.476. At the effective interest rate of 9.38%. The examiner has given us, there's an awful lot to do here for 6 marks. But what you'll actually find in the marking guide is that you can still get 6 marks if you didn't do it fully correct, because we tended to be quite generous because it was so much to do. On an amortized cost approach. So what I would say here is we would have date. How much have we borrowed? Interest at 9.38%. We've got our repayment and the amount carried forwards. So we've got the first of the 6x5. How much have we borrowed? We've borrowed 91.476. Charge interest, 8.58. How much are we going to repay? It's 6% multiplied by the coupon rate of the bond. So we're going to repay a straight 6 million. The same principle applies the following year, except our interest expense increases. And then in X7, that takes us to 100, approximately. There's a little rounding error floating around. The directors are uncertain how the bonds should have been accounted for, so we've dealt with that, and we've also got to deal with the conversion. Upon conversion, the debt and equity figures are converted into share capital and premium. So what we're going to do is we're going to debit debt 100, but we're also going to take away from equity the amount that we originally created. So we're going to debit equity. How much equity arose on the issue? 7.6. But again, there's a nasty little twist. Remember, 1% of it. So that gives us a figure of 7.524. So we're taking out of debt and equity our totals. What are the conversion terms? They're going to be converted into 25 million $1 shares. So credit share capital $25 million and credit share premium with the balance of 82.524. I personally think that was probably worth around about 9 marks. I think it's more than 6 marks. Sometimes that happens. Sometimes that arises. So that's part B1. We're now going to look at the investment in Smart. So what's happened in respect of Smart? We've owned some shares, and treating it as an investment with a carrying value, and we had originally made an election to recognise changes in fair value in OCI. At the 31st of May X7, again, note the date. The date is 12 months ago. It's in last year's statement of financial position. We had a total cumulative gain of 400,000. At the 31st of March X8, we should derecognize our investment in Smart. Because we no longer have any rights in the shares. Per IFRS, the sale proceeds are the sums received of 5.5 million in given shares. Therefore, a profit of 500k arises on disposal on the 31st of the 5th, X8. So what we will do is we will debit shares in given. So we have received a financial asset and we have lost a financial asset. So I'm going to debit shares in given credit shares in smart. They were valued at 5 million. And the gain is taken to OCI because we have made the election to take all gains and losses. The total gain to OCI is therefore 0.9 million and this is transferred via reserves to retained earnings. So we will debit OCE, other comprehensive earnings, 0.9 million, and we will credit retained earnings, 0.9 million. Again, I think there's a lot there. It's a busy question for 4 marks, but if you break it down into a series of smaller parts, we've got a derecognition, we've got a profit of 500,000, we show how that profit, where that profit appears, and we do the transfer. Can you see that's how the 4 marks are likely to be being allocated? So whilst there's a lot to do, it's a busy little piece of the question, it's a bite-sized chunk which I think you can manage. Part 3. We've got our investment in Gao. Do you see this isn't a 25 mark question? This is 4 little questions linked together. They're completely independent of one another. So in terms of our investment in Gao, again, look at the requirements carefully. The company wishes to know how to account for this instrument in Gao's financial statements and the consolidated financial statements of the group. As soon as you see the word and in a question, it means that there are 2 questions being asked. So we've got the treatment in the books of the subsidiary. And we're told Gao trades in zlotys, and we're given fair value. The debt instrument is measured at fair value, and so gains and losses are taken to income statement. It says the fair value of the debt instrument had increased to 12 million zlotys. Therefore, what I'm going to do is I'm going to debit financial asset 2 million zlotys and credit income statement 2 million zlotys in the books of the subsidiary. But I've read the question carefully, and it also says treatment in the consolidated accounts. In the group statement of financial position, the assets of GAO are translated at the closing rate. So at the 31st of May x8, what's that going to be? It's going to be 12 million zlotys. The closing rate is 2. So it's $6 million. At the 31st of May x7, it was 10 million zlotys, and there were 3 zlotys to the dollar. Which gives us a figure of $3.33 million. Therefore, there is a gain in the value. Now, what are we going to do with that gain? Well, we also have to say, in the group income statement, the gain in the books of the subsidiary is translated at the average rate. Well, that gain, it was 2 million zlotys. Our average rate for the year is 2.5 zlotys to the dollar. So we've got 0.8 million appearing in the group income statement. The balance of the gain of $2.67 million less $0.8 million, so that is $1.87 million, is credited to OCI. So we've got two issues here. We've got a financial instrument issue here, and the fair value has gone up, so therefore the gains are taken to profit and loss account through fair value. And we've got a translation issue, and on consolidation, gains and losses are taken to OCI. Aye. Next, item number four. We've got some employee loans. The employees benefit from a cheap interest rate, and so this is part of their overall remuneration. Aron, should measure the debt at the issue date using the amortized cost model because the loan satisfies per IFRS 9 the contractual cash flow test, because we are entitled to receive cash flows, and secondly, the business model test. Aron intends to collect the cash flows from the employees on the specified dates. So the value of the debt at issue date, the first of the six X7, it's going to be paid back on the 31st of May X9, so it's going to be 10 million discounted by 6% for 2 years. That works out as 8.9 million. So in terms of double entry, that's credit cash, 10 million. Debit financial asset, 8.9 million. And debit income statement, a wage cost of 1.1 million. And you show that in the year of issue because the employee is getting that benefit straight away. Aron will also show finance income in the year ended the 31st of May X8 of 8.9 million at 6%. So that's 534,000. So this would be debit financial asset 534,000 and credit income statement 534,000. So what I've tried to do is to address each part of the question, have a little bit of discussion, and reduce everything else as best I can to a series of debits and credits and closing balances and making sure we get the dates right. So that's part B. Let's just take a quick look at part A. First of all, it's only 4 marks, but still 4 marks worth having. And let's take a look at the components of the question. Briefly discuss how the fair value of financial instruments is measured, commented on the relevance of fair value measurements for financial instruments where markets are volatile and illiquid. And it specifically mentions IFRS 13. Now we know a little bit about IFRS 13. So per IFRS 13, financial instruments are measured at fair value using the price at which we're prepared to sell the asset. This price is categorized as a level one market where we have identical assets on an active market a level two market where we might have similar assets on an active market or identical assets on a non-active market. Or we have a level three market which is effectively management judgment. So I've said what IFRS 13 tells us to do. I pick up at least one mark, probably two marks if I can discuss the markets. There's an awful lot here for 4 marks. This means for shares for private companies, there is an illiquid market. And level two or three valuations will be used. This increases the subjectivity. Because we're using management guesses, aren't we? So this increases the subjectivity. Of the figures in the SFP. As a result, information is relevant to users. Because it confirms the past position. But has less faithful representation in the form of capable of being verified, because it's based on opinion rather than fact. And you'll always find that you've got a trade-off between relevance and faithful representation. And I think that's something you can work into a number of questions. Think about the elements involved in relevance and faithful representation. How can they be applied? So that's how to approach that question. Well, that's one way to approach that question. There are others.